So let me welcome you to this talk on existentialism. When I pitched giving talks to the Wauwatosa Library, they felt that it would be a good idea to start with something more basic, and then if there's enough interest, we can do further talks about existentialist philosophy going into particular themes or thinkers going forward. So this is intended to be a really general introduction to existentialism. I know some people have more background in this than others. And it's a very messy, complex movement in not just philosophy, but literature and film, even music, and a few other venues. It spans about two centuries. Some people would say it's still ongoing. There's some debate about that. So what my goals here are really just several main things. One thing I want to do is explain why there's no one single entirely agreed upon or even consensus answer to two of the questions that I framed as the title for this. Who were the existentialists, or who counts as an existentialist, and what was it all about? There isn't any definition that everybody agrees on about existentialism, and you'll see that in as a commonplace in literature. So what I want to do then is suggest three alternate approaches that we can take and put together something like a composite picture. If we can't have a strict definition, maybe we can get some general idea. And one of these approaches is to narrate a story, you know, tell a little bit about the history of existentialism as it develops as a movement. Another is to give you an idea about who some of the key figures are and some of the minor figures. And then the third thing would be to talk about some of the major themes that these figures have in common. They don't all have everything in common. If they did, then we would easily define them, right? Just draw sort of a circle, and whatever's in the circle is in the definition, and whatever is outside of it doesn't fit in with that. Instead, it's more like, think about overlapping circles, like a Venn diagram, or like somebody just dropping paint onto a canvas. Some parts are clearly saturated, some parts seem to be a bit more outside. And then, you know, another thing I'd like to do is discuss whether existentialism is a viable approach to a thoughtful life in the present. Some people see existentialism as something that's finished, died, you know, in the 60s or the 80s. I don't think so. I think it's a viable way to live and to think. We're going to have plenty of time for questions and general discussion at the end, but I don't think anyone should have to wait to ask any questions or raise objections. I'm pretty good at getting things back, you know, to wherever I was going. I'm also very happy to go into digressions, you know, meander off the path. So if you're, you know, if there's anything pressing, just go ahead and ask about it. A few of you know me already, most of you don't. My name is Greg Sadler, and I'm a philosophy professor, but I do a number of other things as well. I produce YouTube videos on philosophy. I do some philosophical counseling. I do quite a lot of consulting and coaching, those sorts of activities. And I give a lot of public lectures as well. If any of you are interested, we have our mailing list that you can sign up for. So let's talk about these starting questions. Who were the existentialists, and what was it all about? And it seems at first like a lot of interesting questions, really easy to answer. And then as soon as you start answering it, it starts to get a bit trickier, a bit murkier. So there's plenty of resources out there to look for an answer in, like encyclopedia articles. You can go online and find the Internet Encyclopedia of Philosophy or the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy. You can, you know, we're the library now, so you can go to the reference section. And you will find them giving you definitions. The problem is they're not all definitions that everybody in the field agrees upon. So they're always somewhat controversial. There's a lot of websites and web pages. There's great books and articles out there about existentialism. And what I wanted to point out is there's sort of three interesting features that characterize most of these resources. So the better ones, the ones that are more reliable, are going to be in rough agreement about certain basic features. You know, for example, that existentialism stresses human freedom, right? So everyone's going to talk about that. Or that existentialists, at least some of them, think that life is absurd or mysterious or murky. It doesn't have a pre-given meaning. But they're also going to disagree with each other about what else fits into the picture of existentialism. So if you compare these articles against each other, sometimes they'll actually refer to each other and tell you why they think the other guy's wrong, which is sometimes, you know, can get quite heated among academics. There's also some writers that everyone will agree belong to the movement. You know, Jean-Paul Sartre, clearly an existentialist. Who else? You know, Nietzsche. Heidegger. Well, except that Heidegger said that he wasn't an existentialist. We'll talk about, you know, those sorts of things that, come up along the way. There's others about whom there's some debate. And some of the existentialists tried to define out other existentialists and say they're not really an existentialist. Some of them disavowed themselves from the movement. And then there's some who more or less get ignored, who are really central to the movement, like, for example, Lev Shestov, this great Russian writer, not very well read today, but he was really central to the movement while it was ongoing. So there's all of that, and it's typical to begin discussions in the literature. There's very few, you know, cases of this in philosophy, where they begin by saying, well, we can't define our topic. We can't really say what we're doing. You kind of have to get a sense for it after a while. You'll have to trust us and see whether there's something there. But that is something that you'll see in a lot of existentialist literature. There's three other complicating factors that make it even trickier. So one of them is that the key figures who we identify as like the grandfathers of existentialism, they didn't call themselves existentialists. Søren Kierkegaard, Friedrich Nietzsche, Fyodor Dostoevsky, they thought of themselves in other ways. It's only afterwards that people start calling them existentialists. Some of the thinkers, like I said, defined themselves in or out of the movement. Albert Camus is a great example. In his lifetime, he said that he was not an existentialist. As a matter of fact, in his one of his main early works, he criticizes the existentialists, who he takes as being people like Gabriel Marcel, or Søren Kierkegaard, or Lev Shestov, and he'll say, I'm not an existentialist. Well, he gets wrapped up into it anyway, because he has all these other connections in common.
I got a question.
Yeah.
When he says he wasn't, did he explain why he wasn't?
Yeah, in main part, he was distinguishing himself from Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir, and at that time, this other guy, Maurice Merleau-Ponty, kind of drops off the scene, and he said, I just don't have the same emphasis that they do. But then, you know, when you look at the key themes of his work, he's in continuity with them. There's a lot of other people who define themselves out. Heidegger said, you know, Sartre was one of the guys who kind of polarized this, quite frankly, because Sartre was so in some ways smart in his self-marketing. He comes out and provides a characterization of existentialism that fits his philosophy particularly well. And then other people are like, well, okay, if that's what it means, then I guess I'm not an existentialist because I don't agree with him on this. Yeah.
They were part of the French resistance, and it was absurd because they kept getting bumped off. I mean, out of that whole group that was...
Oh, you mean like in combat.
Right. Yeah, and then the stranger, he makes use of the absurdity of life.
You know what really killed it between Camus and Sartre was some of Camus' later works, like The Rebel. At that point, there's like a total break between them. There's no possible reconciliation. But we'll come back to this issue of like the dynamics between these guys in just a bit. Let me sort of finish telling you about these factors that make it tricky just to define the thing. The other thing is that different thinkers provided different, you might say, self-definitions of what counted as being an existentialist. So even the people that we agree are in the movement don't agree with each other on what it means to be an existentialist. Many of them were content to say, well, Sartre gets to have the title, and we'll call what we're doing something different. So it's kind of a strange sort of club, you know.
What's a movement?
Well, we can call it a movement, we can call it a club, we can call it all sorts of different things. You know, usually when there's a movement, there's some sort of coherence to it, and some sort of, like, direction, that there's somebody in charge. So it's not a movement in that sense, but it clearly is a set of connections between these thinkers. So there's some people who want to sort of cut to the chase and say, you know, I just feel existentialism is this or that. And in a way, it would be consistent with what a lot of people make of existentialism to say, you go ahead and do that. But then they have to realize that nobody else is bound by that. So if I want to define existentialism as X, and nobody else agrees with it, you know, that's fine from an existentialist perspective, but there's no way for me to bring everybody else into the fold, you might say. What I'd like to propose is a different approach that's been taken. So we do understand it as a movement, an intellectual and cultural movement, and we try to say that there's some sort of coherence because there's some common themes. Not everybody will be involved with every one of these themes. There's also kind of like a network of people who are reading each other and responding to each other, who are influenced by each other. Yeah.
I'm sure someone else brings it up. There's, you know, Simone on here, but were there any women who were thinking?
Sure.
I mean,
she was the most prominent one. Marguerite Duras would be considered in that spectrum. Some people want to include Simone Weil in there.
Simone Beauvoir, was she his lover, Sartre?
Sartre, oh yeah. Well, they had a very complicated relationship. Not only were they involved romantically, but they would get involved in triangular relations as well.
No exit.
What's that?
No exit.
Well, No Exit is about three people who are involved with each other, but they're not Sartre, Beauvoir. The people are not modeled after them. In any case, so the more that we study these thinkers and texts, the more you end up seeing these connections. But it's sort of like a network rather than a, you know, strict dividing line or circle around them. So there we go. If we think about the history, and I created a handout for you that, unfortunately, here's the working of the absurd. Microsoft Word shifted things around. It's supposed to be this way, but these things are supposed to be the right way, so it didn't work out like that. And I talk about several waves or phases of existentialism. We can distinguish four, some people would say five. The first phase is from the early 1800s till about the end of that century. And this is when things are just getting going. Some really early key thinkers reacting in different times and cultures, not in France at all, but rather in Denmark and Germany and Russia. They're working from different standpoints. Some of them know about each other. Nietzsche, for example, read Dostoevsky. Not all of Dostoevsky, but some of what he wrote. He had Kierkegaard recommended to him, but did not read him. So these thinkers are in some sort of connection. And there's debate about exactly who should be included. Some people want to include these other figures like Ibsen or Tolstoy or Chekhov or Strindberg. So you can see it's largely a, you know, Eastern European, Central European, and Russian thing at the start. Then the second phase is the 1900s through the 1930s. Now we get a lot of new thinkers on the scene, some of whom were clearly identifying a new approach in continuity with or reinterpreting the first phase. You know, they would place themselves in conversation with Kierkegaard or with Nietzsche or with Dostoevsky. Some of them were just working through similar or connected themes, and people start using the term that Kierkegaard had used, existential, but people start using this term a bit more commonly. Gabriel Marcel would be one of the important French people at that time.
Religious.
Yes, he was indeed religious. He was a convert. And then the third phase would be like the 1940s and the 1950s. This is what we typically associate with existentialism. This is when it's become a going concern, in part because you're right, it was associated with the resistance, so that gave it some cultural, you might say, ballast. And we have figures like Sartre and Camus and Simone de Beauvoir on the scene writing. And then in the fourth phase, what ends up happening is those figures aren't really working and calling themselves existentialists anymore, but it's made its way to America, and it's broadened itself out into the popular culture. Starts to get a lot more academic study on the one hand. It also tends to get sort of popularized and watered down in some cases, turned into kind of like a commodity. And by the time of the early 90s, it seems pretty much washed up. I don't know if any of you remember that show, Northern Exposure. There's a character who, you know, would have Nietzsche on his bookshelf, and there it just becomes like a reference point, right? Because it never really played any major role, but, you know, somebody's got a book of Nietzsche, you know what kind of guy he is, you know. By that time, you can tell a philosophical movement means something. But a lot of the people involved in it are long since passed on. So then we can ask about, well, what after that? You know, did it die out? Did it continue on? Some people would say that it's, as far as an academic movement, it's dead in the water. But you can still get classes on it. It's become a staple in philosophy departments. I think in part because it's addressing concerns that are always going to rise for young people. Although some of the thinkers are better read in your, you know, middle age, I've found. It's sort of like a perennial plant in that, you know, it's going to keep on getting reborn. So, you know, the mix for an interesting movement. If we look at these phases then, and the question, who were these people? For phase one, it's generally agreed that there's three main figures. There's Søren Kierkegaard in Denmark, who studied in Berlin and then went back to Denmark, dies pretty young. Fyodor Dostoevsky, who was Russian, but also did travel abroad, so he's not, you know, just stuck in Russia. Well, he was actually stuck in Russia, in Siberia, for a while as a prisoner, but he's also looking to Europe for inspiration. And then Friedrich Nietzsche, German, who settles in Switzerland. That's where he does most of his writing. And like I said, Nietzsche knew about these two other thinkers. He'd read Dostoevsky. He calls Dostoevsky a great psychologist. He had Kierkegaard recommended to him by this guy, George Brandeis. Didn't bother to read him. If he had, who knows what would have come about. And there's certain important themes that they have in common. One of these is a focus on the individual. Existentialism, and this is one of the complaints that some people in other philosophical movements or schools have made, existentialism is individualistic in that it says that the individual has to be the locus for philosophizing, you know. Mm-hmm. Instead of just seeing what they do, say, like in our country, it would be, well, what are they doing at Harvard and Yale?
So it's not a movement, it's an individual reflective consciousness.
It's both. It's a movement that involves individualism. So there's not a direct contradiction between the two of those. And, you know, there's also kind of an interesting dynamic there. Like, if you think about Nietzsche, so Nietzsche advocates that we should be individuals, right? We should free ourselves of some of the constraints of society and not take our guidance from anybody. And then you see a lot of Nietzscheans who all get together and talk about how free they are and liberated, and they're not like the crowd, but they become, you know, their own kind of crowd, right? So there's an internal paradoxical dynamic sometimes. Another thing that they focused on, another key theme that's going to run through, is thinking about philosophy not as an abstract, you know, logic-chopping exercise, but as something that has to be lived out, something that has to be experienced and experimented with. This isn't something unique to them, of course. But it is a very strong stress. Another thing that they did was incorporate a lot of literary forms into philosophy. Dostoevsky doesn't write, you know, philosophical texts. He writes novels. In the course of his novels, people do a lot of arguing about philosophy. But they do it as characters in the novels, talking about their lives and about, you know, these other themes. Kierkegaard himself wrote a lot of different types of literature, and he often didn't even publish them under his own name, and he would sometimes have, you know, little discussions back and forth between people who are all Kierkegaard. Nietzsche uses a number of different forms as well, some more effectively than others. Another key idea that they have in common is, and I think here we get to something that's really central to existentialism, is a rejection of what we could call the Enlightenment. A rejection of the narrative of progress, that everything is just getting better and better and better because Europeans and European culture is making the world more rational, safe, clean. These are the people that kind of poke into the dark corners and point out, like Dostoevsky, for example, looking over at America, he was talking about, you know, how technology played out in our Civil War. A lot of people think that the First World War was when European intellectuals realized that the world is not such a nice place and, you know, lights were going out. There were plenty of them that looked at what was happening, you know, the butchery on the battlefield in the American Civil War. Dostoevsky writes about this in The Underground Man, Notes from the Underground. And so they reject this whole sort of notion that by applying human reason and using technology and reorganizing society, we're just going to produce a great world for everybody. So you see them very strongly critical of democracy on the one hand, of socialism, of sort of a technocratic aspect of faith and science. They were also very concerned about mass culture. Kierkegaard has a book called The Present Age where he talks about the crowd and the public. And this is back in the 1840s where he's expressing these concerns. They're still very relevant today. Nietzsche, Dostoevsky, they express these sorts of things. And they're also concerned about determining the value of religion. You know, because Christianity had been an integral part, although, you know, with a lot of internal schisms in European culture for over a millennia. But faith was waning. And there was a sort of a concern about what is the real value of religion. Kierkegaard, who is a religious thinker, would say that he's not a Christian, but he's trying to become a Christian. And he also distinguished between the Christendom of, you know, just going to church on Sunday and showing up and everything going along quite well as one big, you know, coherent system, and then the lone individual who's trying to live out a genuine Christian life. Nietzsche had a much more dismal view on Christianity. He calls it Platonism for the masses and sees it as, you know, part of the decline of the West. Dostoevsky, it's interesting, he's an Orthodox Christian, but you really wouldn't guess it from his characters if you read his novels, because it's usually the atheists who get to have the best speeches in his books. Think of Ivan Karamazov, for example, in his last great work. So you can see there's some sort of coherence there. Now, they're not calling themselves existentialists. That's going to happen a bit later on. In the second phase, now we're talking about thinkers from about the, you know, early 1900s to the mid-1930s. And a lot of these are identified after the fact as existentialists. So what I mean by that is, if you think about somebody like Franz Kafka or Rainer Maria Rilke, they didn't call themselves existentialists. Both of them, by the way, did study philosophy. We think of Rilke is primarily a poet, although he wrote novels as well, and a lot of really great letters. We think of Kafka as a story writer. They both did study philosophy and knew what was going on with the philosophy of their time. But they didn't explicitly identify themselves with any school or anything like that. Some of the other thinkers that we see in there, like Lev Shestov, for example, he was the first guy to see the connections between Dostoevsky and Nietzsche and some of these other thinkers as well, like Chekhov and Ibsen and Tolstoy. And he talks in terms of existentialism fairly early on. We have other great thinkers like Martin Buber, the Jewish philosopher, best known for I and Thou. Karl Jaspers, who is a psychologist, practicing psychotherapist, but also a philosopher, who's influenced by Kierkegaard and Nietzsche himself. José Ortega y Gasset and Miguel de Unamuno in Spain, working with some of these sort of themes. Berdyaev, another Russian immigrant, winds up in Paris. Gabriel Marcel, a religious thinker who winds up in religion through philosophy, who is the first person in France to use the term existentialist, and whose works are connected with that. And then Martin Heidegger, who talks about, in his philosophy, about focusing it on the existential. All of these people are working and writing. Some of them are in contact with each other. Some of them are reading each other. Benjamin Fondane would have been one of the, well, he was one of the only students of Lev Shestov. Unfortunately, he dies in the concentration camps. So, you know, he doesn't really produce much work. But this in this second phase, these ideas are being worked out by a lot of people in different places. And something like a movement is beginning to coalesce. In the third phase, now we're going from like the 1930s through World War II, and then after that, existentialism becomes much more explicitly characterized as an identifiable scene, something like a movement, associated very much with the Parisian scene and with those thinkers like Sartre and de Beauvoir. Some of the figures who fit into the broader movement around this time start to try to extricate themselves from it. So Gabriel Marcel, when you came in, you said, you know, existence precedes essence. That's one of the things where Gabriel Marcel said, yeah, I don't buy that.
He's religious. He's got to have a God.
It's not just that. When you look at Marcel's works, he gives you long discussions about why he differs from Sartre, and it's more than just I'm religious, I need a God. There's a lot of good discussions that have to do with his metaphysics. But the long and short of it is, he says, if Sartre wants to have the term, I'll let him have it. So he cedes the field. Heidegger does something very similar when he reads Sartre's existentialism as a humanism. Until that time, he was kind of happy to have Sartre saying, this Heidegger guy's a really, you know, great philosopher. After he read that, he was like, "Yeah, I can't get on the same page as Sartre."
Being a nothingness.
What's that?
Being a nothingness is another one.
Yes, in which he mentions Heidegger a lot and uses Heidegger. But what Heidegger reacted to is this short lecture, Existentialism as a Humanism. So he writes a letter on humanism saying, Sartre's got things wrong, I'm not an existentialist. And so there's on the one hand, it's becoming part of the culture, right? The broader culture, and on the other hand, it's sort of like, you know, with bands, right? A band becomes popular, and some of the original members leave because they don't like the direction that it's going. It's sort of along those lines. It starts to play an important role in other venues as well. Like, for example, theology. It starts to spill over into figures like Paul Tillich, or Karl Barth, Ruth Bultmann. It starts to influence psychotherapy. So, you know, there was already Otto Rank on the scene, but Viktor Frankl, with his logotherapy, is drawing on existentialist philosophy and steering it. A little later on, we're going to see people like Rollo Mayer, who are going to play a role, but that's in the fourth phase. And then there's a lot of literary and artistic figures. By this time, existentialism has generated a literature. And there's a lot of other people who get involved. Samuel Beckett, you know, Waiting for Godot, I think everybody's probably read that. That's an existentialist work. The playwright Jean Henri, Marguerite Duras fits in there, Ionesco, and also Ralph Ellison and Richard Wright were considered to be black existentialists around that time, adapting some of those themes within a different context. And then we get to the fourth phase, and now it's, you know, it's become a going concern. It's become part of the culture, and in Europe, it starts to get viewed as old-fashioned. In the philosophical scene, by the 1960s, existentialism was something that was well-established in philosophy departments, but it wasn't viewed as where the real action was anymore. Now people start reacting against them. Part of it was about the individualism. They said they don't have large enough social concerns. It still played a major role in literary and film and popular culture. It plays a role in Eastern Europe, in places like Romania and Lithuania, probably as a way to protest against Soviet domination. And in the English-speaking world, it catches on. So, you know, the 60s through the 80s are really the heyday for existentialism over here in the States. This is why we have existentialism classes taught in philosophy departments, because of that era. That's why we have a literature out there of books popularizing existentialism. And it becomes academically respectable, at least in some quarters in philosophy. It was, you know, seen as an opposition to the more dominant mode of doing philosophy, analytic philosophy. So when the continental philosophy people organized themselves, they organized themselves as a society for phenomenological and existential philosophy, sort of a counterweight to that. And then it kind of dies out, at least as far as going concerns. There is still a lot of, you know, writing on, say, Sartre or Camus or Marcel. You can find journals devoted to them. But there's not a lot of people doing a great deal of work in academic circles. The question that's open then is it still viable outside of that as a broader approach for living a thoughtful life? And I think the answer for that remains yes. This might be a good place to take just sort of, you know, maybe 5 or 10 minute pause for any sort of questions, and then we can hit on some other key themes if we want to. We've already covered a lot of ground. Probably, you know,
I have a question.
Yeah.
When you mentioned all these various people, you say they didn't consider themselves existentialists, but they were.
Yeah.
Why were they? What was there about any, and just not all of them, but just one of them?
Okay.
What was there about any one of those persons you named that say they're an existentialist?
So let's take Gabriel Marcel, for example. Right? Marcel is going to, like I said, cede the field to Sartre. Yeah, he's fine calling himself an existentialist at first. After he sees what Sartre is doing with the term, sort of confining it to what he wants to do with it, he says, yeah, you let him have it. What are the themes that Marcel still has in common with all these other people we call existentialists? Well, a focus on the individual and their experience and philosophizing from that, a reaction against enlightenment, science will solve everything, technology will solve everything, way of looking at the world, focus on freedom and what the conditions for it are, focus on moral responsibility. And we could go through all these many themes and say, see, we can go down the checklist almost and say he's got most of these checked off, so he still fits into the movement, even though he himself historically disavows the term. And we could do the same for people like Heidegger or Albert Camus, and they'd be checking off somewhat different parts on the list of themes. So that you might say we're using existentialists in two different ways, two different senses of the words. There's, let's call it existentialist with a capital E, right? And that's what we recognize as this sort of batch of people dealing with common themes. And then there's existentialists, let's say with a small e, and that would be this guy's definition or this guy's definition. And so, you know, from that perspective, somebody can say, well, I don't fit this person's definition, but they still do fit within this larger category. Is that correct? Yeah. Yeah.
During the 60s, people were more interested in philosophy because it was exciting. We had the hippie revolution after the beatnik revolution.
Yeah.
We basically were searching for new ideas. Life can be interpreted as absolutely being absurd. Mm-hmm. The more you think about it, the more you realize that. And so back in 1960, Professor Kalin from the French Resistance was teaching existentialism in Madison.
Okay.
And so and that was a really sought-after course.
Yeah.
I think that existentialism has died. It's still an inquiry into your existence. But I think philosophy has died. You know, who's gonna? It has all the stereotypic merit of art history. I mean, what can you do with?
Well, I like art history. So.
I bet.
Yeah.
But what I'm trying to say is that it's lost. Existentialism. You said it was superseded. What superseded?
Oh, all sorts of things. I mean. There is so much going on in the philosophy world right now and in the popular philosophy world. I actually am the editor of a journal called Stoicism Today. There's a modern neo-Stoic revival. Stoicism Today is just one sort of like little wing of that. And you can look at all sorts of other interesting things where people are not just doing it in the classroom, but they're applying it to everyday life, and young people are getting just as excited about it. That's the bulk of the...
Well, it's interesting, because if you go over to UWM...
Ah, well, that's academic philosophy, yes.
That is dead. If you go up to that second floor of that building, you see these little cubby holes where people...
Yeah, we've got... So philosophy has undergone this process of professionalization, right? And people do have like their, let's not call them cubby holes, let's call them pigeon holes, right? So I do this, and this is the only, I don't go outside of these boundaries, and maybe I'll talk to the person who's got the office next to me if our office hours happen to coincide, and, you know, if we're on the same committee. And that's not, you know, I'm sure I'm going to get, you know, some negative comments from this, but let me just say, that's not a philosophical life. You know, philosophical life would be one that, like you're talking about, where there's genuine excitement because it engages the human person.
Yes.
Right? Not just the pure intellect, but what we call the heart.
Yep.
You're right. Existentialism was able to do that. There are other going concerns in philosophy today that
Sartre was an atheist. Nietzsche was an atheist.
Yeah.
Simone Beauvoir was an atheist.
Mm-hmm.
And the list
so was Camus. And, yeah.
Yeah. But then Gabriel Marcel comes along, and
well, Shestov was a Christian, or no, he was a Jew actually. Although he writes, it's hard to actually distinguish him from Christians, since he writes almost like one. Tillich was a Christian. Berdyaev was an Eastern Orthodox, as was Dostoevsky. So there's religious and atheist members within the spectrum. What's really interesting is the religious members are very often opposed to the conventional forms of religion of their day, sometimes even more so than the atheist existentialists. Like Kierkegaard is a prime example. Mm-hmm. So they're sort of saying, if religion is still going to be, you know, something we want to invest ourselves in, it better be able to deliver something. You know, it really had better have some meat to it. And then guys like Sartre just thought, no, it doesn't. Its day is done. Nietzsche thought it was a bit more pessimistic. He was a bit more pessimistic. He thought we got to get rid of it. It's, you know, it's a cause of what he called nihilism. It's this pervasive state where we don't really believe in anything.
We believe in capitalism.
Oh, so that's another interesting point as well. Some of these guys were, and none of them thought that capitalism was great, right? So, but some of them were very much against movements against capitalism, like socialism, They thought that was just sort of, you know, debasing things to mass culture. Sartre was a guy who really struggled. Was he going to be part of the Communist Party? If so, is he going to toe the party line or not? He had got into a lot of debates. That's also part of why he and Camus broke, because Camus, when he wrote The Rebel, so The Rebel was saying that totalitarianism of all sorts was wrong. And for, you know, some of the members of that group, like Sartre, he wanted to make exceptions for communist regimes. So that's also why Merleau-Ponty ends up getting stripped off as well. But yeah, none of them would say capitalism or consumerism are authentic ways of living. We're kind of stuck with them, you know, because they're part of the landscape. Kafka's particularly good in detailing some of the problems that come up with this sort of thing. But Simone de Beauvoir was very committed to liberation movements as well. So, in a way, what you see is these guys they don't always have the same answers, right? But they are, in many ways, asking the same questions.
Yes.
And they tend to be questions that are very important questions to get asked, and that's why they're exciting, you know. Any other, yeah?
When I was, many, many decades ago, when I was 19, I read a book, I just didn't quickly read through it, called The Outsider by Colin Wilson.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and I don't know, I remember it was called the reading about man's alienation, all that jazz. And I was trying to understand existentialism, and I know there was an idea, at least how I understood it, about to understand life, you had to kind of be closer to death and everything to understand it.
Yeah, that's right. That's an idea that's coming in part from Heidegger.
Yeah.
Wilson was one of these early guys in Britain taking existentialist ideas, which were mostly in, you know, German and French, and like bringing them into the main culture.
I didn't really know much about it, and you know, he was a phenom at the time and everything.
Yeah.
I recently kind of read that, and well, so I was just really, you know, engrossed in everything. I read about it. I had moved out east and spent a lot of time alone and was reading it, and then I moved to New York, and what I did was I jumped out of a plane. I wanted to know
with a parachute, right?
Well, yeah, I landed and everything. I'm a little short. I did it, yeah, and I wasn't into athletics, sports, and all that. So I did it, and it was a philosophical thing, trying to understand existentialism. But I was, so young then, and I guess I was trying to understand it. And I'd like to reread the book. I haven't yet, but I'm trying to, I just remember so many ideas and so many authors he talked about. It wasn't all just about existentialism.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I don't think he just talked about, I don't know, I have to reread it. What author would he, or what philosopher would he, would have had that idea? Being close.
Well, Heidegger talks about. He's pretty dense, but there's good sort of literature to sort of wean your way into him. So Heidegger talks about being towards death, and that we're not aware of it most of the time. That we're gonna die, and we feel anxious about that. A sort of pervasive sense of anxiety. And we hide this sense of anxiety from ourselves through all sorts of ways. Like, think about how some people just binge watch show after show after show because they don't want to think about, you know, anything else. Mm-hmm. That would be an example of that. Or any sort of consumerism, just trying to fit in. With Heidegger, most things end up being inauthentic. I think he's kind of a pessimist that way. But then when we have these experiences that we don't control, that can shake us out of that. So like jumping out of an airplane, you can imagine to yourself like, well, okay, first I'm going to put on the parachute and the door's going to open. And now I'll step out and I'll pull the parachute. And it turns out to be like nothing like what you expected, right? And many other experiences are like that too, like going out on a date can be like that. It turns out very different than you expected. Very bad or very good or something else. You know, there's a lot of different. Some people have these through experiencing an illness, you know, or the loss of a friend or a family member. Camus talks about this in terms of the absurd.
In The Stranger.
Yeah, but also in The Myth of Sisyphus. He says that the absurd is like waiting for us, lurking all the time, and you can't predict when it's going to pop out. He's got some really beautiful passages that I can't recall word for word about it. And it shakes us out of our sort of complacent day-to-day attitude and makes us reach out for these, what Heidegger calls existential themes. You know, what is the meaning of my life? What the hell am I doing? You know, what's this all about?
Questions are too painful for modern-day society to deal with.
Well, that's a good point. And we see this already with Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard thought that that's why people were so conformist in his own 1840s Denmark, that people just didn't want to deal with having to take responsibility as an individual for asking these questions and then trying to answer them themselves. But, you know, it's interesting. So you mentioned being very young and reading, you know. The first existentialist work I ever read, I didn't know anything about the existentialists at the time. It was in high school, and my uncle, Aimé, had Camus' Myth of Sisyphus. And I borrowed it from him because I thought, well, that's cool. I like Greek mythology. You know, I figured there'd be something about, you know, Sisyphus in there. It turns out you got to wait till the end to find out. And I read it, and I understood maybe, you know, one passage out of 10. And you know, later on I read it in college again, and I didn't, you know, I responded to it. I thought it was really cool, and it, you know, parts of it made sense, and I started reading these other existentialists. And I went back to reading these people about 2 years ago when I did a year-long series for a library in New York, a monthly series where I would focus each month on one particular existentialist author, read as much of their stuff as I could, call out the main themes, we'd have a discussion about it. And I was so surprised by how much more there was for me as somebody in my 40s than there was for this kid back in his teens and early 20s. It's not that there wasn't anything there, but I think some of these grand themes start to make more sense to us as we get older. Particularly, like, you know, when I didn't have this attitude when I was in my 20s at all. But nowadays, when somebody proposes a project to me, I think to myself, well, I could be doing this, or I could be doing all sorts of other things, because I'm probably going to be dead before another 40 years are up. I've already lived more than half my life. Time's getting shorter. What do I want to do with that time? Because it starts to become more and more pressing and precious, right? Now, it could be that, who knows, maybe we'll all live to some greater age. Technology will improve that. I don't know. But that's what Heidegger calls being towards death. That's an existential way of looking at things. It helps to put things into perspective when you say to yourself, you know, I could get hit by the bus tomorrow. I think when you're in some of these great works of literature, they have more to say to us when we've accumulated more life experience, when we're sitting in a better position. Yeah.
So by the same token, did these existentialist writers do their writing when they were a little older?
So some of them died young, right?
Yeah.
like Søren Kierkegaard died in his 40s, and von Dane, he died, let's see, he was only 46 when he dies, but he's in the concentration camp. Rilke dies pretty young himself.
Like Kafka dies young.
That's right. Kafka dies young.
Camus.
Now, go ahead.
Camus. Did he die in a car wreck or something?
Yeah.
And so he had no idea that that was going to happen, because when he accepts his Nobel Prize, he has this speech where he says, "I'm really too young to be given this kind of award. This should be for like a writer who's, you know, contributed more in their prime." He didn't realize that's all he's getting.
That was the absurdity of life.
Yeah, exactly. I think he could kind of get behind that. But so to your question, some of these writers produced considerably greater works towards the end of their time, like Dostoevsky. You know, Dostoevsky goes through a great maturation process. Personally, The Brothers Karamazov is said to be his greatest work. I really like it. I also think it's translated either as The Possessed or The Demons is also equally great. But that's a later work, too. If we think about some of these other people, so Sartre, you know, shows great promise early on with Nausea.
He was in the French Resistance, and they faced death on a daily basis from the Germans.
That's true. But so Nausea is written before that. Being in Nothingness is going to come about in the middle of the war, right? And then as time goes on, he writes more and more. Simone de Beauvoir continues writing throughout her entire life. I think her stuff gets better as she gets older. Who else would Marcel? I think his stuff gets better as he gets older too. But you know, some of them just didn't get the opportunity to get older. We don't have control over that. Mm-hmm. So it's too bad, because if you think about like what, so I'm a big fan of Rilke, not just as a poet but as a letter writer, somebody telling us about life. He dies just around 50. What would it have been like if he'd lived into his 70s? You know, you look at how great his work was when he died. What could he, or think about Kierkegaard. What could Kierkegaard have contributed if he'd lived another 20 years? Probably some pretty amazing stuff, but we'll never know. You know, so good question. Let's talk about a few other themes then, because we've talked about quite a few of these. But I want to leave you with at least sort of a catalog, you know, that checklist, right? So the individual, we talked about that as the locus for philosophy. You brought up alienation with the Colin Wilson. One of the key themes that all these figures do talk about is this sense of things not being right, being out of sorts with the world. Urban life, bureaucracy, work in sort of meaningless contexts, conventional relations, these are all common themes. Nietzsche calls that nihilism, the loss of meaning in the modern world. Another big thing that I touched on is choice and responsibility. All the existentialists say that we're not completely made by ourselves. It's not like this capitalist notion of the self-made person. But we do decide what to make of ourselves given the circumstances that we find ourselves in. Some people have more freedom, some people have less freedom. So de Beauvoir will say, you know, we can't hold everybody to the same standard. If somebody grows up in a horribly abusive household, you're not going to say that they have the same degree of freedom to determine their own destiny as somebody who grows up in a much better situation. Somebody who grows up in you know, terrible poverty, in a third world oppressive government, is not in the same situation as people in the West. But we all do have some degree of freedom, the existentialists say. And a lot of what they think, you know, people do is avoid using that freedom and put it onto other people or put it onto other institutions and say, you decide for me. And so the existentialists, they sound somewhat callous sometimes. Sartre will say everybody's responsible for what they do. Everybody's totally responsible for what they become. And that can be, that ties in with the anxiety part too, because once you realize that you are responsible and it's not somebody else, that means that you have to decide what you're going to do with that freedom. What are you going to do with your capacity for choice? The issue of the absurdity of life. So Camus talks about the world as being absurd. Sartre uses similar language. Not everybody saw it exactly the same way. Simone de Beauvoir says it's not absurd, it's ambiguous. It can have multiple meanings, and it's up to us to give it a meaning. So there's a big difference between, say, her and Camus. Gabriel Marcel says that reality is mysterious, meaning that we have to sort of dig into it if we want to get meaning out of it. It's not there on the surface. It's going to take a lot of digging, and we have to realize our own involvement in that. Mood and emotion, that's another thing I didn't talk about in this, but that's a really key theme. All of these thinkers spend a lot of time focusing on either analyzing or culling out the implications of or depicting, if they're novelists or poets, moods. So anxiety is one that they talk about quite a bit. But joy, what is, you know, does joy have a philosophical meaning to it? Is there a difference between, say, being joyful and just being content or, you know, just enjoying things? Sadness could have a very important role as well. They not only see emotion as something valuable. Heidegger, for example, says that emotion is one of the ways in which we perceive the world. So it's not just about our intellect and our ideas. A person who is angry and who's angry all the time literally sees a different world than the person who is sanguine or the person who is bored. And so mood is really central for them. And I think the last thing that I would point out is none of these thinkers are systematic thinkers. There is a system that you can sort of reconstruct from, say, Sartre's being and nothingness. You can talk about that as a system that Sartre has. But it's an anti-systematic work, in part because they've got this stress on individual choice and freedom and things not really making sense. And if they're going to make sense, we have to cobble together meaning out of what we're given. And so they tend to distrust systematic philosophy, which probably goes to why it's so exciting, too, when you first get introduced to it, especially for younger people who have usually had quite enough of system already. You know, they've had all their whole lives, especially this generation, too, of younger people who have their lives almost micromanaged. I'd imagine they could get a lot out of going to college and running into an existentialism class, hearing some of these themes, and then saying, I'll embrace them. But they do see philosophy as more of a practice, you know, an ongoing experiential thing than something that you can just put into a set of doctrines. So that's all I've got as far as my discussion notes for this talk. So any other comments or questions, or I'm happy to go into, we can have general discussion if you want. It doesn't have to be just me talking.
I was going to suggest that there are the relationship between individual and society is a perennial problem for lots of different perspectives. And I think there's a big difference between thinking for yourself and thinking by yourself. So, the notion that existentialism must have that focus on the individual in the society as opposed to society at large, I think may be a mistaking of the potential of that.
So some existentialists seem to be more of the by yourself vein. Some of them really, some of them do stress the for yourself with others. Simone de Beauvoir is a great example. Gabriel Marcel, you know, stresses solidarity and even, you know, his understanding of communion with other people. Sartre, not so much. I mean, I think Sartre, people make they read Being and Nothingness and they see his analyses of your possible relations with other people and they look pretty dismal. You know, we brought up No Exit. If No Exit is really sort of taken as Sartre's picture on human relations, it's not a happy one. You know, everybody's going to be opposed to each other. But some of them are, you know, and with some of them, there's kind of like a, lost opportunity for that, like Kafka, right? You think about some of Kafka's works where there's all these like near meetings of people, and then they wind up going off in different directions, and they can't get it together, you know? I guess Rilke has some things sort of like that, too. Yeah.
Well, I think part of that may also, just to follow up, is that other people can disturb your thinking for yourself.
Yeah.
So that there's a little bit of the solitary thinker there, but that doesn't mean the philosophy itself has to follow that particular need.
Yeah, not just can, but often do. I mean, you could decide to be Nietzsche up in his little garret writing books, you know, by yourself, or you'd be out in, you know, Rilke's another interesting example that way. He loved being with people. He hated being in cities. And the reason he hated it is because he felt that you really couldn't be an individual in a city. There wasn't the ground for it. And I think it's in part because he had this sort of agrarian ideal going on. But there's something to that. Yeah.
I think, this is my own idea, that in 2016, where we're at now, is we can do functional MRI brain scans of people, and we're all walking around with 3 pounds of meat in between here and here, and that's our whole universe. There's no society, there's no individual. All of that is in here, because the senses take in the information, and this is the thing that records it and interprets it.
Yeah.
And so I don't think that they had that back in 1960.
Well, they had plenty of theories about, you know, things reducing to the brain back then. Behaviorism was in full swing.
Right, but now we can actually watch it.
We can watch something.
We watch the brain scan going
on.
Yeah,
sure.
We know what
true.
The hormones are. We know what oxytocin does.
Oh, yeah. We know more about the workings of the brain. Doesn't mean that everything reduces to the brain.
Well, I think you can reduce the individual to the biology of this of the organism.
I don't mind that myself, but
I think most scientists will say they don't have any more of a grasp on consciousness, for example.
Yeah, no. it's considered the hard problem.
That's entirely in the field still of philosophers and theologians.
There's not only that, but we do brain scans under extremely limited circumstances. And, you know, the sample sizes that we're drawing, we're generalizing about everybody in the world based on this tiny little sample size. Scientists themselves are going to say you got to be careful about drawing massive metaphysical conclusions from.
All right. Is an atheist and somebody that believes in God, do they have the same brain scan when they, let's say, they recite a prayer?
Some studies say yes, some studies say no.
All right, the studies I've seen say categorically yes.
That's great then, you know. I mean, what that shows us is that certain activity is taking place, it's going to get better and better and better. We're going to get finer and finer grained stuff. But again, there's what we can observe, and then there's what we can conclude from it. And there's a big gap between those, you know. I think there's a lot of sort of wishful thinking, and this is what has been said about this, not just in our own time, but any time that people were drawing these reductivist conclusions. This goes all the way back to, you know, what the positivists were doing in the 19th century. It's the same basic attitude that, well, we understand this thing, so we can extrapolate from that to everything else. And, you know, we can certainly disagree about it.
Well, there's the great courses, you know, you said.
I've seen them,
There's a course called Science and Religion.
Mm-hmm.
And in there, he shows you all these pictures of the experiments they're doing at Trinity College. So it's there for anybody to look at.
Sure.
But okay. I think that was something that Sartre, they didn't talk
about. No, you're right. Sartre didn't see brain scans. But Sartre certainly writes a lot about the attempt to sort of reduce the human person down just to a scientific understanding of the human person. He talks about this in Being and Nothingness. He talks about this in terms of human freedom. It's very difficult to find a do a neuro scan that's going to show us where freedom is located, for example. Because it's not that sort of thing. It's not something that just reduces to a brain state. But again, this is one of those things where I don't think we're going to find common ground on this. So somebody else had a question, yeah.
I have two questions unrelated.
Sure.
Did Ralph Waldo Emerson influence any of these thinkers?
Yeah. He influenced Nietzsche, as far as I know, but I'm not sure how. And later on, I read something about him influencing somebody else in this batch, but I don't remember whom offhand. He's an interesting figure, too, in part because there's this attempt to sort of like read existentialism backwards into history and pull in figures that have some themes in common, and Emerson is one of those thinkers that sometimes people do that with. So is Nathaniel Hawthorne and Herman Melville.
Yeah, I mean, because they're just stuffy New Englanders, separated from Europeans and everything.
They're reading like all the European stuff that comes their way, though.
Yeah.
And they're getting their German philosophy in part through Samuel Coleridge, who's popularizing it at the time. That's where the transcendentalist movement in part comes from.
Well, I like Emerson has influenced my life in philosophy.
Yeah.
It's kind of my religion, my personal religion or spiritualism.
He's quite an interesting guy. Yeah. What was your second question?
Well, my second question is, would you think of any of the circus with the Republican candidates?
Yeah.
Would you think of any of them as kind of existential?
No.
or the Democrats?
No. I wouldn't think of any of them.
As a philosophy professor.
Here's the one way in which they would have some affinities with the existentialists. So Trump and Sanders both are seen as anti-establishment figures, and they both are pretty frank in speaking their mind. They're saying very different things, right? So one is very clearly on the right, one's very clearly on the left. You compare that to the other candidates and the stuff that they were saying. And if we were trying to, let's say we made an existentialist spectrum, right? So Trump and Sanders would be further along on the existentialist spectrum than, the rest of the party people were. But I don't know. I wouldn't say it wouldn't be easy to identify either one as existentialist.
I want to honor some of the general thrust of your talk. You've been sort of careful not to say, you've been very descriptive and careful not to say why you see, you're just documenting that the existential movement seems to be petering out to some degree. I wonder if you could speculate a little bit on that.
Well, I think it petered out. You mean like in the 60s through 80s, 90s sort of thing? So, in philosophical circles here in America, existentialism fit into continental philosophy, which was sort of like the alternative to analytic philosophy, which is what dominated and still does dominate most departments. The existentialists, we were like a generation behind, So what was happening in Europe with France and Germany and Italy, they sort of like shook off existentialism by like 1960. And so you get these new, philosophers coming out that say, we're going to do something different. And so then by the 1980s and 1990s, if you're going to the Society for Phenomenological and Existential Philosophy, you're finding less and less stuff on existentialism. and more stuff on whoever happens to be popular figures in France and Germany. And they just kind of get supplanted. Some of those figures are also, they have a beef with the existentialists. So Michel Foucault, for example, said, yeah, I couldn't stand that existentialist stuff, you know. And so, you know, Foucault becomes popular over here. And people are like, yeah, Foucault must be right. Let's not read Sartre anymore. Things like that. There's the academic side, and then there's the popular side. And I would say it never really totally died out in the popular side, in part because these existentialist thinkers do respond to some perennial concerns that keep popping up for us, you know, like anxiety. You know, think about the types of anxiety that we face in our current economic climate, you know. Young people, will I ever be able to have a house? How am I going to provide for myself given what seems like a worsening and worsening job market? Maybe reading existentialist thinkers might have some applicability there.
So when your critical theory takes over and drives out existentialism as a counter to, or as a, not a foil, but something that actually works against its agenda.
Yeah, in part because they see it as too individualistic for the most part.
That's adopted here, and then that same frame becomes adopted here.
Yeah, you know, we talk in a joking way in philosophy about certain thinkers or ways of doing things as being sexy, being, you know, what's on, you know, the thing of the day. And existentialism quit being sexy after a while.
It's not trending.
Yeah, that's a better way to put it. It's not, there's a lot of faddishness, I think, in contemporary philosophy, unfortunately. But there's a much bigger conversation. You had a question. Yeah.
I was going to comment. Can you explain humanism?
Thank you.
Sure.
And kind of, is it an extension of it? Is it a side tool?
I would say what you could think of it as sort of like, you know, when you have a Venn diagram, you have two overlapping circles. So some existentialists, like Sartre, for example, he's got a piece, Existentialism is a Humanism, right? And then Heidegger said, yeah, I'm not getting into that humanism stuff. That's where I part ways with you. So he'd be in that other circle. And so some humanists are existentialists, and some existentialists are humanists, but there's no absolutely necessary connection between them. Other people who would probably say that existentialism is a humanism would be like Gabriel Marcel and Jacques Maritain, who's an existentialist Thomist. The existentialist psychotherapists are definitely humanists. I mentioned Rollo May before. He'd be a great example. Viktor Frankl, I think, fit in there too. But, you know, as far as like the humanist movement, that's a good question. I don't know that historically there was, I don't think existentialism gave that any like ballast of its own. I think they really were a going concern already on their own. And they drew in, like, so think about, for example, John Dewey, who played a major role in the, I think, the first Humanist Manifesto. He was definitely not an existentialist. He was a pragmatist, American philosopher. So they could draw, this is a big tent kind of thing, I guess you could say. Yeah. Any other questions?
Maybe Foucault is an example.
Yeah.
Can you give another one?
Oh, of people who were not very, who thought that existentialism was something to leave behind.
Yeah.
Gilles Deleuze would be another example. Jacques Derrida, Theodor Adorno, who is associated with critical theory, he's from the Frankfurt School, he really went after the existentialists very hard, because he's a Marxist, and so he thinks that existentialism is terrible, because although they're like, you know, grasping that there is human suffering, they're taking an individualistic perspective on it, and not turning towards, you know, transforming society. Who else?
That's okay.
Okay.
I get it.
Yeah. Now, if you had to pick who of those to read, I would read Foucault, right? Because
I know him about that much. So,
yeah. Adorno is just, he's great, but man, he's tough to summarize. You know, Derrida is kind of, I find Derrida annoying. So.
I think he's annoying on purpose.
I think you're right, but he is annoying. Yeah.
Yeah. I have a question. It might be as simple as a yes/no, but would you think that the impression I get is that Nietzsche came along and kind of drew a line in the sand and said, you know, why are we always taking these, you know, philosophical concepts and we try to create these big constructs that are universal and eternal, and once they're pointed out to you, you have to agree with them.
Yeah.
Before Nietzsche, if a philosopher is going to create something universal and lasting, he has to rectify it with the absolute, and in so doing, has to rectify it with religion. And then after Nietzsche, I think there's a general tone of philosophers going, yeah, why did we try to always equate our universal system with a Judeo-Christian religion? And after that, more independent philosophies that fall less and less back on the church, fall less and less back on the religiosity.
I would say that Nietzsche, so like the sort of like trend that you're drawing, Nietzsche's not there at like the start of it. He's like here along after it's developed a good ways, because the whole positivist movement, you think about that's predating Nietzsche. And Nietzsche thinks that you know, attitude of you know, science is going to solve everything, we strip away religion from it, that happened in the Enlightenment.
Right.
He thinks that that's the same thing as religion. In the genealogy of morals, he says that the man of science is just a new priest. Because he believes in an absolute, he brought that word absolute, he believes in an absolute truth that we can have access to. So it's no longer provided by God, you know, the church, whatever. Now it's being provided to us by science, but they still have what he calls the will to truth. Nietzsche wants to get rid of that. That's what makes him so radical, you know.
If you tried to define science, you'd have the same problem you tried to...
Yes.
It just can't be done.
Yeah, it's tough. And the problem is there's multiple definitions floating around out there that have...
You were talking about extrapolation.
Yeah.
You know, some things you can extrapolate, some things you can't.
Yeah.
I remember years ago reading about something in Switzerland where they had horses and they were worried about horse manure. And they figured another 50 years they'd be knee-deep in horse manure. You know, but things happen and things don't stay the same, so you can't extrapolate. Only if everything stays the same can you extrapolate.
You can only extrapolate about bullshit.
Not bullshit. Not bullshit. Let's not talk politics anymore.
Okay. Well, you know, we do have the town hall tomorrow, so I think it's on people's minds. Any other questions or comments? Or yeah, go ahead.
I'm not sure this is a real that I can ask this properly, but I've read a little bit by Ayn Rand. So when you talk about nihilism.
Yeah.
Is she influenced by whom, if by anybody?
So, Rand is a strange case. By the way, in academic philosophy, she is like totally verboten. You know, I will in an ethics class, I'll teach Rand because I say, well, she's a philosopher. She's got a coherent perspective. I'll teach her alongside Aristotle and you know, John Stuart Mill and people like that. As a example of egoism. That's pretty off the wall for most people. Rand doesn't like Nietzsche, but actually looks like she has more in common with Nietzsche than she thinks. She's a huge proponent of Aristotle for all the wrong reasons. Now, I love Aristotle. I'm an Aristotle scholar. But when I read what she has to say about Aristotle, I'm like, that's not Aristotle. That's not what he's actually saying. And she's also equally, like, totally against Plato, because Plato and Aristotle represent, like, two different archetypal positions on things. I do enjoy reading her work the same way I enjoy reading other people who I don't agree with, but find very interesting to think about. I think that most people who read her are reading her because they're already convinced before they begin reading. And because somebody, you know, recommended it and it just fit that. Or because they're just cherry-picking things, terrible things that she said that they can then post on, you know, whatever. And it's interesting, though, because there's been some recent academic work on her by people who are not Randians, who look at her as a virtue ethicist. And, you know, I think you could do better, but she's interesting to look at. She's, you know, there's a coherent philosophical position there that's been totally excluded from academic philosophy. And so because it's been so excluded, it's developed its own set of institutions and discourses. There are quite a few people who read her and follow her these days, yeah. Did you have your hand up? Or?
No, I was just listening.
Okay. Well, should we draw to a close then? Everybody's totally, you know, completely...
befuddled.
Oh, good. I was trying to search for the word. Like, everyone totally understands existentialism. Or if you do, then they're better off than me.
Yeah.
But
you got us hooked. You got to come back.
Oh, good. Well, thanks for coming, and very much enjoyed the questions and the discussion. So I'll see you. Whoever wants to come for the next one, I'll see you here. Otherwise... have a good night.